Excited to be in the house of the Lord tonight. Amen. It's always good to be with our church family. Amen.
Amen.
And I believe with all of my heart, I mean, I've been praying over this. Pastor asked me to kind of hit this on the fly, and I prayed, and I thought, well, you know what? As the Lord just kind of started downloading stuff into my spirit, I'm like, okay, you know what? We're going to do a little reiteration, and then we're going to move a little bit forward. How about that?
Good.
Amen. Amen, amen, amen. Now, Pastor, what I love about Pastor is he's been teaching us eloquently about Revelation, about the times that we're living in, all the mess that's going on. It's in the Bible. Amen? It's already been talked about. And we're constantly being taught about what's coming, what's coming, what's coming, what's coming. But the question that keeps hitting me in my spirit is, when it comes, are you going to be ready? Because times, hard times are coming. And, you know, well, let me say it like this. Just let everybody know I love you. I'm not mad at anybody. I ain't hating on nobody. You know, pastors say we forgive everybody, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. But the thing is, you know, I even find in my own self, I say that I'm ready, but am I really ready? I'm just speaking about me now. I can't talk for everybody else, but I can speak about me. So I thought then, what got me thus far? And what's going to continue to carry me to the next level? And what that is what we talked about last time. Having the what? The confidence in who?
In God.
Confidence in, come on everybody now, let's. Confidence in who?
God.
We're going to have confidence in God. Now, what we did is, I have some pass outs, like Pastor always, I was talking to Pastor about this earlier today. One of you young bucks mind, please, por favor, thank you. I'll give one to Pastor.
There
we go. Okay, so I wanna make sure everybody get this and let's roll through this, because what I wanna do is, when we talk about confidence, I want to look at, just kind of reiterate what the Old Testament talked about, amen? And then what I want to do is let's move forward to the New Testament and see what the New Testament says about having confidence in God. Everybody say confidence?
Confidence.
You got to have confidence in the Lord, amen? There's a song that says what? On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is what? Sinking sand. And I don't want to be standing on sinking sand. I want to stand on the rock. I want to be able, when that time comes, if they put a gun to my face, Lord forbid that ever happens. But if it does happen, then I'm going to say, you know what? I'm standing for Jesus. You do what you got to do. But as far as what I got in my heart, I'm standing for the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Okay. So now let's look back at, if you look at confidence, and let's look at the Hebrew. And it has like a little, y'all can see that, you just got to flip the page. So let's look at the Hebrew. Everybody got it? Okay. Now, let me get myself together. Okay. So what it says is confidence, and we talked about confidence is the batak. Y'all remember that? The batak. And what does the batak mean? It means to be open. And it says that where there is nothing hidden, a person feels safe. Everybody with that? Where there is nothing hidden, a person can feel completely safe. Or in other words, when I'm standing in the confidence of God, I'm standing in my safe place. Everybody say safe place. Come on, safe place. I'm standing in my safe place. See, when I get outside of this safe place, then when the enemy comes and attack me, then I have nothing to stand on. Amen?
Right.
See, I thought about this the last time, but I said, okay, I'm going to illustrate it this time. All right. Okay. All right. See? Nobody be superstitious, okay? Dancing in the rain. Okay, let me get serious. So here's my safe place, But when I get outside of my safe place, what I'm doing is I'm standing under the law of sin and death if I'm acting upon that, amen? But God didn't call me to act upon the law or stand under the law of sin and death. He called me to stand right here in my batak, my safe place, amen? So what, now watch this. So see, if I get out of my safe place, guess what happens? I begin to start viewing people differently. Right. Come on now. Right. Let's be real. Okay, we're going to be 100 about this, right? I start viewing people differently. See, instead of me viewing you through the eyes of the Spirit, if I get out of my confidence, then now something's going to begin to creep in me. Something could rise up in me. And as soon as you cross me, then I'm going to start looking at you like old school. And I try not to go old school now. I tell them boys all the time, I try to keep that bear underneath my feet, you know. But see, then I start looking at you through the eyes of jealousy, or I can look through you through the eyes of anger, or I can look at you through the eyes of bitterness, and I know that if I'm acting bitter towards you, then obviously I'm standing and I'm operating under a complete different law, amen? Amen. And that's not what God called us to do. Now, one of the things Paul talked about, and let's turn to the scripture, it's Galatians. And like I said, I'm just going to touch on this because I really want to move forward. Let's touch on it. Galatians, and let's look at chapter 5. And I think it's verse 26, if y'all can put it up there for me. Galatians, chapter 5. Everybody there? Verse 26. And if you have it, everybody say go. Okay, and it said, let us, everybody say, let us. Let us not become vainglorious and what? Self-conceited, competitive, and challenging, and what? Provoking and irritating to one another, envying and being jealous of one another. Now see, if I'm acting, obviously there was something going on in the church where Paul had to actually address this, because if it wasn't going on, he wouldn't have talked about it. Okay? Because he's trying to say, look, you're supposed to be operating in this realm. In this realm, not under that realm. Pastor and I talked about it just a little bit ago. When we accepted Christ, we became a new creature. All things have passed away. Now it's a work. Now it don't come. Sometimes some things completely just whoop, it's gone. But then sometimes there's that work. But that old is supposed to be getting its way out of me. But that's only if I'm in my safe place. It can't work its way out of me if I'm operating under a totally different law. Right, right. Amen? Amen? That's why you got to operate in the batak. You got to live in the batak. You got to habitate in the batak. Because if not, soon as you get out of sight of this, the devil gonna be right there. Oh, look how she acting. Look how she looking sideways. Look what he's doing. Look what you see what I'm saying? So here's the thing. Paul said, let us not be conceited. And if I'm conceited, guess what it means? It means it is an exaggerated opinion of oneself. It's vanity, or I can say it's pride. Yes. Pride. We're not supposed to be conceited towards one another.
Right.
Come on now. Pastor keeps pushing it. You know, can I just a little sidebar? Because, you know, Pastor and I had this really cool talk. But I remember I said, Pastor, you remember when me, you, and Michelle was sitting in the office and just the state of mind and the state of emotional state that I was in at that particular time? And I never even thought that you could pay me to get up here and preach again. Look at God. Look at God. I don't take the credit for that. That's God. That's God. But God says, son, you got to stay in the batak. You got to have confidence in me. Get it off yourself. Pastor always says, people, we looking at our situation. We look at our circumstances. Then we get bitter and we get angry. And that's natural. That is natural. You know, if you get crossed, it's natural for you to get upset. And what I realize is, you know, I'm a fighter. You know, I mean, you know, I really am. But you might not see that side of me because I stand in my buttock. Amen. I stay in my safe place. But once I get outside of that safe place and you catch me on a bad day, oh boy, you know. So when I'm at work, I'm constantly, okay, Lord, buttock, 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 buttock. Amen. So here it is. So if Paul says, be not conceited, because if you're conceited, then you obviously have an exaggerated opinion of yourself. And if you have an exaggerated opinion of yourself, then that means you're acting in pride, and pride becomes before the fall. And who got kicked out of heaven because of pride? Okay. Just like the fallen star. Thank you, sir. And watch this. And if I'm acting in pride, that means I'm insecure. Amen. If I'm operating in the buttock, and if I'm operating in the confidence of God, that means that I have a firm foundation that I stand on, like we just said, on Christ, the solid rock I stand. And everything out here might be rattling and rolling and shaking all around me. But see, as long as my feet are planted firmly in the rock, then I can't be moved. Remember we used to sing that song? I shall not be moved. I don't know the rest of the words, but that's okay. Thank you, ma'am. I shall not be moved. Amen. So get planted. Amen. And pride stems from the law of insecurity. And again, I just want to say, if you're prideful or you're acting any kind of way outside of that, you're insecure. You don't got to just be prideful. If you're bitter, you're insecure. If you're angry, you're insecure. If you're hateful, you're insecure. But whatever you do, if you're operating outside the confidence of God, you're operating in the law of sin and death, and that is insecurity. Hallelujah. Amen, 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 amen. Okay, so you say, okay, Willie, well, maybe you might be right. Maybe, dude, you know, I might have a little bit of this thing in me. Well, it's an easy solution. Like Pastor always said, it's easy. All we have to do, if I'm insecure, if I'm out of place, then get right back into place. It's easy. And stay there. I'm not saying it's always easy to stay there, because, you know, you get this little pull match going on. But you have to know, whenever you get out the bed, whenever you're at the house, when you're in the grocery store, wherever you are, I'm secure. Because here's the bottom line. Wherever you are, y'all heard me say this, wherever you go, there goes the kingdom. Right. Hallelujah. Wherever I go, there goes the kingdom. So I bring the kingdom in Walmart. I bring the kingdom to work. I bring the kingdom at home. So it's either I'm operating in this kingdom or I'm operating in that kingdom. Which kingdom you want to operate in today? Wherever you go. And don't think that people don't see it. People know what time it is. They ain't stupid. Oh, that dude said he a Christian, but I don't know. That joker sound like he off the tilt, you know. But here's the thing. So we have to stay in our rightful place. Everybody say, I gotta stay in my place.
I gotta stay in my place.
You have to, church, because this is what carried me, and I really believe God gave this, because this is how we're gonna have to operate if we're not already operating in it in days to come. Amen. And here's the thing. You're not operating in the kingdom just for you.
That's right.
It's dual-fold, amen, twofold, amen, because not only am I operating in the kingdom for myself so that I can be blessed, but guess what? When I'm operating in the kingdom, somebody else is going to be blessed, amen. Other people are going to be blessed. When I get around the lost, they got to say, man, there is something about this cat. I don't know what it is, but there's something about this dude that is something on him. I don't know what it is. I don't like it. Maybe I do like it. But whatever it is, whenever I step into the room, here comes the kingdom. Amen. It's for the lost. Our confidence in God is for ourselves, but it's also for the lost. Remember, confidence is a safe place. So therefore, come here, Floyd, please. So therefore, whenever Floyd comes around me, either way you want to come, hey, buddy, what you doing? No. Whenever Floyd comes around me, then Floyd ought to feel the kingdom in me. He ought to be feeling something in him, and he ought to feel safe and comfortable. Now, sometimes when people feel safe and comfortable, they don't like it, and they don't know how to respond to it, but they know that there's something that I'm supposed to be feeling when I get around this cat. Thank you, Mr. Floyd. You're awesome. Give Floyd a hand. You see? See, it's the lost world that needs to experience God's people acting in confidence in Him so that we can create that safe place. Amen. And here's the thing. It's our responsibility to provide that safe place for the lost people. They see, people are lost. They're not standing on anything or under anything. They're not standing on anything. So therefore, somebody has to be God enough, Christ-like enough to say, you know what? I can provide you safety and I can provide you security. And where does that come from? That comes from my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. That's why when you get around me, you just kind of picking up the vibe. You're picking up the kingdom vibe, you see? And that's what happens when we stand in confidence in God. Amen. It's just like this. It's just like, I remember, you know, one of my favorite things was I always used to love going to my grandmother's house. And the reason why I always loved going to my grandmother's house is because she always knew I liked to eat. So she always had a plate of food. She always had something on the pot. Oh boy, go on in there and get you something to eat. And what I felt from her was safety. I felt secure. I felt like I can be myself, you know, and just like a child. That's the way a child feels when, you know, and that's the great thing about children. Children can tell sometimes if you're genuine or not. I don't know what it is. Maybe it's just because of their innocence. I'm not really sure. But it's something about a child. If a child really feels comfortable around you, then you got to be okay. I mean, some kids are just naturally shy. But in general, I feel that if a kid really feels very comfortable around you, then you got to be hopefully an okay dude. I mean, I know there's all kind of roads we can go down with that. But y'all basically know what I mean. So, and the thing about it is children, this is what I love about children. Children are always open to love. Amen. And so this is why I love standing in the baton, because God knows I'm open to love. And he just pours out his love on Willie, and he'll pour out his love on Floyd or Michelle or whoever. He'll pour out his love, but you got to stand in the right place to be able to receive it. See, if I'm standing here, I mean, yes, I can hear him calling me over there and hopefully I'll respond, but I can have a better response of his love when I'm standing in his confidence, amen? When I'm standing in the safety, when I'm standing in security, amen? You got to be open to love. Now, I love this part. I love this part. I love this part. I love this part. Now, watch this. Now, we're talking about being open to love, right? Now, when I'm open to love, then that means I'm going to express love. You express, thank you, Holy Ghost, you express what you open to. Mm-hmm. I don't think y'all just, did you catch that? You express what you're open to. So if I'm going to be open to bitterness and anger, then I'm going to express it. You know, if I'm going to be open to bitterness or whatever, I'm going to with love. Now, once I get outside of that, then the enemy is going to constantly try to barrage you with other things that he's just on his job. He's just on your job. But that's why God gave you the armor. Come on now, because you got to protect your love.
That's right.
Protect your loved ones, yes, but protect your love.
Right.
Guard your heart with all diligence, for out of it flows the issues of life. Thank you, Holy Ghost. So in order for me to understand love and to express love, I got to be able to receive that kingdom life coming in me, because I can't give what I don't receive. See, if kingdom love ain't coming in my spirit, then I sure can't give it.
Right.
Amen. I can't give what I don't receive. Amen. So we got to be open to God's love. Once we're open, then we can express his love. And guess what kind of love we express when we're open to it? We express perfect love. Amen. And the scripture says, godly love does what? It casts out all fear. See, I know what it's like to experience hellish fear. I know, I nobody can't tell me. I know. I've experienced it, okay? But as I begin to dwell in my safe place, God just kept pouring just as much as I can receive. Because sometimes you can't receive pour it all on me, you know. Pour it all. What happened? I'm sorry. Okay. Pour it all on me, Lord. Pour it all on me. No. No, son. Right about that. Should I grab the handheld? Oh, you think I'm... What you trying to say, Lord? Get a new mic, man. Okay, so check it. So sometimes we can only just receive just a little bit at a time. But if you receive it and you get it in your spirit, then you're going to begin to express it. Express it. Express it. Now, I'm going to, you know, and I know I constantly talk about Pastor and Michelle and all these guys, but I can't help but to, because I'm here because of that. You know what I'm saying? Part of that healing process. Amen. But they kept pouring just a little bit. And just a little bit, and Pastor give you a piece of paper. Read that, son, and then you read it, and then you read it again, and then you read it again, and then you fall down, then you get back up, and you read it again, and you read, and just little by little by little by little. And now I hope that because I received perfect love, I hope that when in the world I can begin to express perfect love. Amen? Amen? Because perfect love does cast out all fear. And think about it. We have been redeemed by perfect love. Amen. Our minds have been renewed by perfect love. Amen. And guess what? Perfect love binds us together as a family. Amen. 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 And so the dynamics, and I just want to read this, the dynamics of perfect love create such an atmosphere where the glory or the light of love dispels darkness. So see, not only perfect love casts out all fear, but perfect love dispels darkness. And Pastor gave me a powerful illustration. We were getting ready to walk out the fellowship hall and come over here, and he just turned on the lights, and he said, "Is there any darkness, son?" I said, "Nope." So you got to flip that love switch. Amen. You got to let God flip that thing in you. You want change? Then, okay, fine. God wants to change you. But you got to flip. You got to let him flip the light, and you flip too. Everybody flipping, amen. And after the flip, we're all filled, you know, with perfect love, amen. So because God wants to dispel darkness. Darkness should tremble when we operate in total confidence in God, amen. So that's why it's so powerful when you walk in the grocery store, hell's already trembling. Oh, she's operating in that confidence. Uh-oh. And then he'll try to get you to go down the salad aisle when God told you, look, I need you to go down the potato chip aisle because there's somebody there that needs love. The world is so desperate for love, y'all. Come on, isn't that the truth? I mean, people are so desperate that they do all kinds of different things out there. And it just seemed like it just multiplies different ways of doing the same thing. Basically, your heart is full of darkness, baby, and you just need somebody to love on you. And that is our responsibility. Amen. Light changes the atmosphere. Amen. And again, the love of God will always, always, always dispel darkness. Now watch this. You have to ask yourself, because the Bible says that, as a matter of fact, let me, I'm going to pull the scripture up real quick. If you guys mind turning to 2 Corinthians 13 and 5. 2 Corinthians 13 and 5. Please. 2 Corinthians 13 and 5. Because I heard Jake say it like this, and that's he's still one of my all-time favorite ministers of the gospel, T.D. Jakes. But Jake said, what's the point in saying you're a Christian? What's the point in reading the word? What's the point in going through all this if you're not going to be changed by it? What is the point? The point of it is we all need change. It don't make you a bad person. It don't make you a whatever kind of person. It just makes you a person that needs to be changed. We all need it. It's no big deal. There's no big eyes or no little U's or whatever else in between. You know, there's none of that. Okay, let me turn to the scripture. I know I got it on the board, but I risked. Okay, but is everybody there except me? What did I say? 2 Corinthians 13 and 5. And I know it's on the board, but I like to read it. Okay, 2 Corinthians 13 and 5. Now listen to it. 13 and 5. Now let's check this, guys. Now we're talking about perfect love. It says, examine and test and evaluate your own selves to see whether you are holding to your faith and showing the proper fruits of it. I don't like that sometimes. I don't know. Can I be real? I don't like that sometimes. Oh, you know why? Maybe the thing? Okay. Thank you, Brother Chow. No. You're good. Oh, okay. I see.
You want to hand it to me?
Okay. Yeah.
There's only one way.
There we go. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah. And I'll just... Thank you, Papa. Okay. That's not an easy thing to say and do, amen? I don't like really sitting down and examining myself and then being honest with myself. Because sometimes, you know, we want to... Oh, no. You know? Isn't that the truth? It hurts. But isn't that what the scripture says? It says, test and prove yourselves. Do you not yourselves realize and know thoroughly by an ever-increasing experience that Jesus Christ is in you, unless you are what? Counterfeits, disapproved on trial, and rejected. That's a powerful scripture, y'all. See, sometimes we read the Bible, but do you really read the Bible? This is something we need to constantly do. We don't, okay, thank you, Lord. See, we think that, thank you, Holy Ghost, we think that if we examine ourselves, then we're condemning ourselves. But the Bible says that we're not under condemnation, okay? Now, if the Holy Spirit convicts you, see, there's a difference between conviction and condemnation. See, when I'm being condemned, it's just like a building, I'm being torn down. You condemn buildings. But when I'm under conviction, the Holy Spirit is prompting me to say, look, son, you know I love you, you know I care about you, you know I want the best for you, but you got to change in this area, amen? You have got to change. Why? Because there's a purpose that I want to fulfill in your life, and you're going to cut yourself short and not fulfill your purpose if you don't allow me to change you. Amen. Hallelujah. Come on now. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. He wants to change you. He wants to change me. Had I not, I tell people, I think I said this the last time. I said, Lord, you can't make me come to church. I ain't going to church, and there ain't nothing you can do about it. Make me. And then Michelle said, Willie, you can. That's what it was, the movie and the food that hooked me, you know. God said, I know how to get them. I know how to get them. I know how to get them. But I kept fighting him tooth and nail. Son, go to church. Come on, go to church. Go to church. Go to, I ain't going, you know, that, that, that. And I had my whole list. And God said, well, Mr. Biggity. Okay. So now you Mr. Judge now. You taking my place now. You God Almighty now. And I said, no, sir. I said, no, Lord, I ain't no God Almighty. You know that, man. I mean, come on. He says, you need to go to church, son. Because see, you don't see what I see. Hallelujah. See, God sees us in such a totally different light, amen, and I thank God for that, amen. I'm so thankful that he sees me so differently than sometimes I even see myself, amen. But I'm willing, because God always knew in my heart, I'm willing, I want to change. Because I know that if I don't, then, you know, who's the next person that I could bump along and share the gospel with, or da da da. You know, just all kinds of things could be happening in and through our lives if we're willing to change. Amen. Now, am I good on my time? Okay. Thank you. Okay. Now watch this. Ooh, I love this. Now watch this. Okay. Now. Oh, my goodness. Okay, help me, Lord, because I get so excited sometimes when he shows me different things, and I try to say, okay, Lord, help me slow down so I can convey the message, okay? Oh, my word. Okay, now, if pure love dispels all darkness, and God says that your home, okay, in you should be the place of security, amen? And when I'm secure, then others can feel secure around me because maybe they may be needing something from me. Like someone that's lost, they need the gospel, so they need to see Jesus in me, amen? And so, therefore, this is why love is so critical in us, in our homes, in our children, and it's so generational. Amen? It goes from you to them, from them to them to them to them to them. And it's just like, if I may say, like, why husbands and wives should feel secure. Now, I don't know why the Lord told me that, but that should be total. And as a matter of fact, Pastor was saying that earlier today, and you didn't even know I was going to say this, Pastor. Right? We didn't talk about this before, but Pastor says, you know what I can do? I can turn my back to Susan and know that she won't stab me in the back. That's it. Amen? He says that they have such a relationship, and I said, man, pastor, you know, I'm a single brother, pastor, come on, man. Ease up just a little bit, please. No, I'm just playing. But he says that there's such a security and such a stability because he's open to love, she's open to love, and therefore they express love to one another. Therefore, they pass that down to their children, and their children pass that down to their children. See, you know, and what you are is what you're going to pass on. What you are, can I say that again? What you are is what you're going to pass on. So what are you passing on? Can we be real about that? What you passing on? That's why it's so important to make sure that we're open to perfect love. Amen. Because this whole thing is just, it's like God just created such this system. And once we find out what the nuts and the bolts of the system are, all we got to do is just turn, you know, we get the wrench and we turn it. Turn your love, you know what I'm saying? They used to have a song back in the turn your love around. Dun, 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 dun. Don't you turn me down. Okay, okay, that's all I'm going to say. Okay, I'm sorry. Okay, whoop, whoop. But watch this. Now, I love this. Thank you, Lord. I love this. Because, see, if I'm operating in anything other than pure love, see, the Lord says that you're supposed to be walking in the Spirit. But, see, he said walk in the Spirit. He said not walk in a spirit. Right. Oh, ho, 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 ho. Woo! Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You're supposed to be walking in the Holy Ghost, not in a ghost. Now watch this. Now watch this. Oh, this is beautiful. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. This is beautiful. Put up there, brother, Luke chapter 9, verse 51. Oh, this is powerful. This is powerful. This is going to be a blessing to somebody. It blessed me, and I'm being blessed by it right now. Woo-hoo! Woo-woo-woo-woo-woo-woo-woo-woo. Are we there? I'm not there. You know, maybe. Help me, Michelle. Okay, thank you. Okay, now let's keep just what I said now about perfect love and what you receive and how we operate. Y'all, we got that, right? We good? Everybody good? Now, I'm not moving too fast. I mean, we good? Because, I mean, the whole thing is, I know I get excited because I got something out of it, so I'm trying to convey it as steady as I can, okay? Now watch this, now watch this, now watch this. Let's look at, okay, let me make sure I got that right. But, okay, 51, okay. Got it, okay, 51. Now when the time was already come for Jesus to be received up to heaven, he steadfastly and determinedly set his face to go to Jerusalem, right? And he sent messengers before him, and they reached and entered a Samaritan village to make things ready for him. Now watch this. But the people would not welcome or receive or accept him because his face was set as if he was going to Jerusalem. Now watch this. Here's his boys now. Watch his boys. 54. And when his disciples, James and John, observed this, watch this, they said, Lord, do you wish for us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them, even as Elijah did? And he turned and rebuked them and severely censured them, saying, he said, you do not know what sort of spirit you are. Let's go to the next one real quick. For the Son of Man did not come to destroy men's lives, but to what? To save them from the penalty of eternal death. And they journeyed on to the next village. Okay? So see, this is why it's critical that we operate in the Holy Ghost. Because see, when I'm operating under the law of sin and death, then the next thing you know, you cross me and I want to rain down fire from heaven on you. And Jesus had to rebuke, saying, okay, boys, I know y'all been hanging with me, and I know y'all think y'all cool and y'all down with me, but you don't know what spirit you are of.
That ain't the Holy Ghost. That's a spirit. A demonic spirit. And how many times we can look at ourselves and say, you know what? I wasn't operating in the spirit. I was operating in a spirit. Come on now. Hallelujah. Y'all still love me now. Still love me now. Still love me. See? See how all this works? I mean, you see, you kind of see the whole system playing out. See, that's why it's important that I have confidence in God. And I maintain. Now, again, we're not perfect. No, but we can receive perfection. Amen. Make sure I'm right, Pastor. Okay, we can receive that perfection when we receive that love, amen. So therefore, when I get when I'm walking down the street and somebody stepped on my brand new sneakers, you know, I'm not trying to call down lightning on top of their heads. Because see, thank you, Holy Ghost. See, the Lord says that in the last day, many offenses will come. See, if you ain't been offended, watch out, you will be. It's coming. And it's going to increase as we move on to the last day. So like Pastor says, we can't be sending people up to the moon. No, 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 no. Because eternity is at stake here. See, think about it. They were so conceited because, oh, yo, we hanging with Jesus. We hanging with the man. Oh, they got a little pep in their step now. Okay, they got a little bounce going on now. And now thank you, Lord. They've let themselves get so comfortable with the man that they forgot what the man represented. Hallelujah. And sometimes we do the same, don't we? We get so comfortable that we forget whom we serve, whom this God is. Amen. He's King of Kings. He's still King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He's still coming back soon. He's still great and powerful. He's still a mighty judge. Amen. He's all of these things. So don't get so comfortable, and in your comfort, you become conceited, just like they did. They got so comfortable. Oh, don't you talk about my Jesus like that. Who do you think you are? And watch this. Okay. And y'all make sure you keep up. Oh, I love this. Watch this, y'all. Oh, you're going to enjoy this. You're going to enjoy this because this blessed me. This blessed me. Watch this. So at that particular time when they got all self-righteous and all ready to strike down and call down heaven and all this different things, how many of us, yes, do the same thing, and we do it, thank you, Lord, we do it thinking that we're being zealous for God.
Right.
See, they thought that they were being zealous for God. You're not being zealous for God, dude. I can tell you that. Thank you, Papa. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Mm-hmm. See, you got to stay right here. Don't get rattled. Don't get shaken. The word will go on. Amen. Stay steady. Keep on breathing. Okay, 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 okay. Thank you. Thank you, Papa. I love this. I love this. Because they thought that they were doing God a favor. You think that you're doing God a favor, but you're not doing God a favor. Actually, you're boosting up the enemy and you're making room for the devil.
Right.
But you think that you're zealous for God and you're doing something great for the Lord. And the devil's like, that's exactly what I wanted you to do. Now, bam, bitterness,
Bam, hatred. Now you're ready to call down thunder and lightning and rain all this mess down on people. No, 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 no. And I tell you, you know, I have my days where but you know, the cool thing is, Pastor keeps teaching over and over and over and over and over. He says, you bless and not curse. Bless and not curse. And I can't, and some days, you know, for hours, I'm in my mind, bless and not curse. Bless and not curse. Bless and not curse. And then all of a sudden, something will jump out. I said, wait a minute. Come back here. No. Bless and not curse. Bless and not curse. Because if you bless and not curse, then what's going to happen? You're going to receive a blessing. Amen. So if you want to be blessed, bless and not curse. Amen. Amen. Okay. So I'm not trying to turn my back to you, but I hope we, okay. I think we can get through this. I think we can. I'm going to do my best. Okay. So they thought that they had zeal. You didn't have no zeal, dude. Okay, now, watch this. I want to make sure I get it right. And I'm going to try to make sure I make a copy of this so next time everybody will have it. But zeal means, in its original text, means to
emulate.
And what does emulation mean? When we try to be like somebody, or we try to make yourself, you know, whatever. So, or we could say, trying to equal or, okay, steady baby. Okay, emulate or trying to equal or excel. I would be like the Most High God. Who said that?
Right.
Y'all remember that? He said, I will set my throne above the heavens. Amen?
Yeah.
See? Thank you, Lord. See, Jesus said, the scripture said that Jesus didn't think it robbery to be equal with God. Oh, my goodness. Whew. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Okay. So he didn't find it robbery to be equal with God. But Satan, on the other hand, he just didn't want to be equal. He wanted to be. He wanted to excel and be God. Amen. And so if I'm zealous, then what am I really doing? I'm thinking that I'm either trying to be equal or even excel God. Y'all getting it? Watch this. Another example. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Thank you. Watch this. You're Peter and you're the rock, and the church will be, what is it? Be built on the rock, and the gates of hell will not prevail. Okay, so now he got that word. Now, oh man, I got my word. Then in the same sentence, well, the Son of Man must be crucified. Oh, no, you're not going to be crucified. That's not your will. That's not what you're supposed to be doing. See, at that moment, because he felt he got him a word, he was trying to, felt like he was equal or even excel past God, because in his mind, he didn't get the revelation. Jesus is supposed to die. I'm supposed to die, Peter, but I'm placing the kingdom mandate on you all. But don't you think that you're equal? Or even remember when Peter, you know what? I'm going to wash your feet. No, Lord, don't wash my feet. See, it can go opposite. Either you can be bold about it, or sometimes we say we got that humility. Oh, no, don't. That kind of like that sense of false humility. See, all that's wrapped up in this word zeal. Amen. Amen. So this is why when I'm in have confidence in God, then I'm going to learn to humble myself before God, because I'm in His presence. I understand who He is, and I'm not going to try to equal myself or let my zealousness try to put me over Him. Because see, if I'm operating in a whole nother spirit, like right here, in a spirit right here, then I think I'm God. So that means I'm trying to say either I'm equal or I'm better or bigger than God. That's why we shouldn't judge one another. Because if you do, then you're saying that you're either equal or you're better than God. Hallelujah. Come on now, that's real talk, right? Can we keep it 100? That's real talk now. We're all done though. I'm just as guilty. I've judged people, you know, but the scripture says if you judge, what's going to happen is going to boomerang back on you, and you're going to be judged yourself. Amen. So this is why, you know, you got to watch your zealousness. And these boys just got all out of pocket. That's what we say, you know, around work. They just got out of pocket. We're not supposed to get out of pocket. Amen. Okay. Are we good? Everybody with me? Okay, so watch this. So this is just like the roots of the word. Okay, that's why I love rapping with Michelle, because she's kind of cool. She likes this kind of stuff too. Okay, so watch this. Oh, I love this right here. Ardent endeavor or devotion. Okay, and I said, okay, Lord, that's cool. I ardent endeavor or devotion. But you know what I asked him? I said, Lord, I don't even know what that means. What is ardent? I told him straight up. I said, I don't even know what that means. So Lord, you got to just break it down. And sometimes the Lord just got to break it down. That one was for y'all. Okay, so ardent in its root means to burn. Okay, or a flame, fire. You got it? So ardent. Ardent endeavor or devotion, and that means, again, and this is the root, okay, to burn, flame, whatever. So, and like Michelle said, she was right on the money with the definition. The real definition is intense, oh boy, intense feeling, or right, exactly, or passionate. Okay. Thank you, Pop. Oh, burning desire. So now, when we look back, let's look back at the scripture real quick. Verse 54, please. Verse 54. Everybody there? Okay, and it says, and when his disciples, James and John, observed this. Let me just thank you, Lord. Let me just make a quick pause. See, if we can just learn to keep, and I know it's cliche-ish, but if we really can learn to keep our eyes on Jesus, other stuff we won't really pay attention to and cause us to get out of pocket too. Because see, if I'm constantly looking at something that I find offensive, then I'm going to defend it, you know? And I think I don't know if it's so, if it's more of a guy thing than a girl thing. I'm not really sure, so I'm not saying one way or the other. But I know that when I'm offended, I want to defend myself. You know, like I said, you know, I told y'all, you know, you're a fighter. So you and I think that's just human nature. Maybe you automatically get charged up. You offended my Lord. God don't need you standing up for Him. He don't need me defending him. He can defend himself. Right. Yeah, you know? Exactly. But the thing about it is, when we look at, then boom, rah, you know? And that's why you got to keep your eyes on Jesus, amen? Because when you keep your eyes on Jesus, then your focus on Jesus, and where your eyes is where your feet will follow. Your feet's going to follow what you keep looking at, amen? Amen? Everybody with me? Okay. So, 54. Okay, so when they observed this, they said, Lord, do you wish us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them? You see, I mean, they're asking him such a, that is such a, if I can, I don't know if I should say that word, but it's such a dumb question, you know, or a dumb statement, you know, Lord, should we call down fire? And, you know, and we get so into this zealous thing, and we get so passionate about, and we get so, ah, yes, Lord, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And the Lord says, you're not even operating in the Holy Spirit right now, Willie Tillman. You're operating in a spirit and not the spirit which I told you to walk in. He said, walk in the spirit and you shall not fulfill what? The lust of the flesh. Even though, yes, there's that constant battle, but I've got to learn to continue to just walk in the spirit. So, and this zeal is, and there's nothing wrong with having zeal, but it's just what is your zealousness focused on? Their zealousness was focused on defending God. Their zealous was focused on vengeance. So that's why the Lord got mad and rebuked them. That's why he rebukes me quite often, because my eye want to look at this and my eye want to take care of that. But he says, your eye supposed to be looking this way and not this way. Turn your eyes towards Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Amen?
Amen.
That's the key, folks. That's the key. I don't have my content. Okay, thank you. So the question is, what are we focused on? What are we looking at? We got to ask ourselves these tough questions. Am I really receiving the perfect love of God daily? Because again, what I receive is what I'm going to express. And everybody around you going to know what you expressing. Everybody around me going to know what am I expressing. And I'm speaking to myself now, because I got my days too when I'm fooling nobody, you know. It's me, man. Man. You see what I'm saying, Lord, you know. So you know what I need to do? So, hey, oh, watch this. So the next time if you see somebody, you know, like let's say your husband or wife or a friend, and, you know, they just got in one of them, you know, whatever, you need to go to the batak. And just walk off. Don't tell me to go to Batak. I'm in the Batak. What you talking about? I'm in the Batak. Oh, yeah, really? Say that again and look in the mirror. Is that all right? Oh, don't tell me. I know I'm operating. I got love. Okay. Let's turn to 1 Corinthians 13 then, baby, and let's talk about what love really is. Well, what love got to do with this? I'm sorry. Yeah. What love got to do with this? The batak. I tell you what, we'll end on that happy note, and if Pastor would allow me, I still got some other pieces to the puzzle, and maybe Pastor will allow me to come back and do it again. But let's do this. Let's just really, really take some time and let's really take a look at ourselves. Amen. Hey, I'm not the Holy Ghost. God already knows what's going on in my heart, in your heart. He already knows what's going on. And isn't this the safe place where we can lay our burdens down? See, we say this stuff all the time. And then the Holy Spirit's like, you know what time it is. You know what time it is. You know what time it is. And watch this. See, the more I shut myself off to the Holy Spirit, the more I shut myself off to God. And how can I hear God if I got him shut off? Amen? I can't hear God if I'm shutting him off. That's why we got to be open. Remember? To be open. Batak, to be open. A safe place. This should be one of the safest places on the planet. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. And when the Spirit moves, see, thank you, Lord. I'm going to say this one last thing. See, I remember, like, even in my own experience, the Holy Spirit will be touching me and moving me, and then I'll be like, well, I ain't going up there because I don't want them to think that, you know, whatever. What that got to do with, my mama used to say, what that got to do with China and beans and whatever that saying is. You know, beans and rice or whatever. What that got to do with anything? It's about you and God. Because you know what? If I was married, my wife is not going to give account to God for me. I got to give an account to God for me. You got to give an account to God for you. So why are you playing? Why play with it? Because, see, I want to be all that God has me to be. I really do. And I'm not just saying that, man. I'm just not trying to be zealous and, you know, I am zealous, but, you know, I'm not trying to front about that. I mean, I want to be, because I understand I've seen the darkest of night, and God has brought me into the light, and I want to stay in the light. Be in the light, you know what I'm saying? Like DC Talk say, I want to be in the light as he is in the light. And I want to shine like the stars in the heaven. And the only way I'm going to shine is if I stay right here. I get in my rightful position. Amen? 24/7. And like I said, sometimes it's not, but then you remind yourself, I need to get in the batak. I'll be right back. Where you going? I'm going to the batak. The batak, what is that, you know? So if you need to tell somebody go to the batak, tell them, look, you need to go to the batak. You need to go to the batak. I'm telling you.
Go to the batak.
Tell your child, go to your batak. When they get on your last nerve, mama and daddy, go to your batak. Amen. So did we have some fun tonight?
Yes, sir.
Did we learn some stuff tonight? Amen. Let's give God glory. So let's just take a little bit of time. I know the time is getting ready to take, but we don't have to get up. We don't have to make no big production of it and all that. But let's just quiet our hearts. And just between you and God, and you know what you got to get straight, you know what you need to talk to him about, this is the best place. This is the best and the safest place. Yeah, you know what I'm saying? Amen? So let's just take a little time. Amen. Thank you, Jesus.